So the agenda for today is to demystify cloud computing and virtualization. And you know, it's just a funny picture where working on cloud means sitting on the cloud and doing something. Okay. So the agenda is look at what virtualization is, look at what cloud computing is, and have some time around for the question and answers. Okay. So feel free to stop me if you have any questions at any point in time. And I'll be glad to answer. Okay. Fine. So we know what virtualization is to some extent, right? But why is it needed? I mean, any technology for that matter is in a way a solution to an existing problem, isn't it? Okay. So what happens is that you start off with a problem. We start somewhere where there is a problem to start with. And then we find the solution that will solve the problem. So to understand the solution better, it's always good to start with the problem itself, right? So if you look at virtualization as a solution, okay, what problem does it solve is the first question. So can you tell me what kind of problem does virtualization solve?
I guess it provides. Started with maybe cost control. That is how it started.
Okay, cost control is an interesting point.
Yeah, right. So basically, you can pack more servers into fewer amount number of hardware.
Okay.
But now, I mean, after that, it basically gave the other advantages too, right? Like redundancy, high availability, easy mobility between places, easy deployment.
Okay.
Ability to archive something, complete host, and maybe bring it out after a few years when you need it again. So lot of cool advantages are there. So, I mean, I guess my point is that it started with something and it gave all the benefits that we see today.
Okay. So you say that it all started with cost benefit. Obviously, that's a very, very important point. And
Started with cost in the shape we see it. I mean, virtualization has been around for many years,
correct?
Even before VMware, but those have been with different motives of maybe with performance also sometimes, right? IBM based systems,
correct?
But in the enterprise field, basically, I guess it started with cost.
Okay, I understand. So, how do you see virtualization actually doing it? Prasad, your thoughts?
Yeah, basically I can say it gives, apart from the advantages which we spoke about, it gives some kind of simplicity.
A simple example, some sort of a metaphor for the whole, virtualization cloud computing stack, where we said, we solve a set of problems through simple methods, and we apply the same thing to using cloud computing for IT infrastructure and other stuff. Okay, so the metaphor here is traffic. Okay, we know we all have no matter which country we are, but traffic is a very huge problem that we have, right? There's huge amount of traffic everywhere, and we talk about different things and stuff like that. Right, so we'll use traffic as an example for ourselves to understand this whole virtualization and cloud computing. How does it work? And we can draw a parallel to how we can use it in different IT services. Is that okay? Can you look at the picture now? Hello. So. You understand, right? Now you look at the picture and tell me, what do you see? Hello.
Traffic jam.
Yeah, so traffic jam, right? This is exactly not the appropriate picture, but the idea is to show that how we can apply virtualization kind of a scenario in this kind of a setup. Okay. So, if you look at, building a road is very similar to how we build a architecture or how we can build a, IT infrastructure as such. Okay. So, So we are going to build a road. What are the factors that we will take into consideration? How do we go about building a road?
I mean, you build a road, right? You lay out asphalt and then bring some steamrollers, I guess.
No, not that way. I mean, not. I'm not talking about the process. Okay, let me rephrase the question. How do you go about designing a road? How do you decide what kind of capacity it can have and etc.? What are the metrics to it?
Well, we gather requirements, I guess. That's how we start.
Okay.
Right,
so and number of, it's based on number of vehicles which we expect.
Exactly. So the number of vehicles that we expect are the amount of traffic is directly involved in the decision of how long the road has to be or how broad the road has to be, etc. Right?
Mm-hmm.
You understand,
how
right?
How much money we have?
Obviously. since the roads are not built by individuals, money comes more at an government level, so the roads are actually private. Anyways, that's a good point. Anyways, it also depends primarily on the number of people who will cross through a certain place at a given amount of time, right? We build the capacity, correct? The road has to handle some amount of capacity, and how do you plan that capacity is in the way that you build the road where n number of people will cross in some amount of time. And the road should be able to handle that amount of traffic, correct?
Correct.
Yeah. So, what happens is that we don't build it for now, correct? When we build something, what do we build for? What will we keep in mind while building something? What are the most important metric? You guys are architects and consultants, you know that. We don't build for current usage, right? How do we build?
Yeah, but future purpose.
Yeah, so there is a futuristic point of view. So, for example, when we build a road that's going to connect point A to point B, then in 5 years or 10 years time, what is the kind of traffic that we are expecting in the road? That is how we will build, correct?
Yeah, that's true.
Yep.
Okay, so and when we say this, any traffic will be variable in usage. At times there would be not much, there at times there would be much. And as I said, if we say in 5 years, 10 years, this is the amount of traffic, then the traffic grows over a period of time. So whatever we build in general, with the future in hindsight, the idea is to build something for the peak usage, correct?
Correct.
So, in a given point in time, when we build either a road or an IT infrastructure, the maximum usage or the peak usage at a given point in time is a major metric that we take into consideration, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, let's have a very simple hypothetical situation where we build a road considering 10,000 people can cross that road in every 5 minutes.
Okay.
Okay, we have currently built a road that was like, say, built 5 years back, and the assumption was that 10,000 people, okay, this is for understanding, so you don't have to get into the details, but 10,000 people, traveling in 5 minutes. Okay, this is a very generic statement, right? 10,000 people traveling means we don't know certain set of things. What are the things that we don't know? We don't know the number of vehicles or the number of people in a vehicle or at what time, nothing we know, correct? That's how we build an IT infrastructure also, isn't it? We don't know every single detail in place, but we expect certain things to happen, and that is the day we build the infrastructure, isn't it?
Yeah.
So, in this case, when we say 10,000 people in every 5 minutes, now let's add one more detail to it where we assume all people will travel only in cars. Okay.
Okay.
And all people, all cars of the same size. All are 4-seater cars. Okay. there is a one particular model of car everybody uses. Did you understand the question I asked? I was asking you a simple thing where you have n number of people, okay? You have 10,000 people, just people, and replace number of people with number of cars now. How many cars can run there?
10,000, I guess.
10,000, is it?
You said replace people by, yeah, or 5 people per car.
Yeah, so you can do anything. I mean, just do some math and tell me the answer.
I mean, how many people per car? I don't know.
Yeah, you can assume something. That's not a problem.
Okay. 2 maybe per car.
Okay, in those cases, how many?
5,000.
5,000 cars should be able to, right? What I'm telling is that, think of it like 10,000 people walking on the road and we are replacing them with cars. In that case, the general count has to be around 2,500, 2,000 to 2,500, where we assume 4 or 5 people per car, correct?
Correct.
That's what a typical car can consume, isn't it?
Yes.
A car can handle 4 to 5 people, so if we replace people with cars, the number has to come somewhere around 2,000 to 2,500, correct?
Yeah.
So the road can be filled only with 2,000 to 2,500 cars, isn't it?
Yes.
Right.
Isn't it? Now what happens, frankly, how many people travel, 4 people in a car or 3 people in a car or 5 people in a car? Hardly anything, right?
Yeah.
Most of the time, it's one person or two person, isn't it?
Yeah.
The road on a given length can handle only 2,500 cars at best. In that case, actually 10,000 people would have traveled in the cars. But what actually happens is that, since we are not completely utilizing the car, the road gets easily filled up, isn't it? The road gets filled up and the cars are not filled up, isn't it?
Yeah.
In that case, the road becomes full very soon, but the number of people who are traveling is much less than what it should be. From the outside, if you look at it, we would be thinking that we have consumed the road. The roads are not enough, or the infrastructure is not bigger enough. But what happens is that we have superficially fulfilled the road, but internally there is so much of space available, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Now the basic problem is that everybody has their own car, and everybody travels individually, or one or two people in a car. That's the primary reason.
Yeah.
In that case, what solution can solve this? What could we do to solve this?
The first most available resources to
make bigger roads, I guess.
Come again?
Yeah, use the available resources in a better manner.
In a better manner is more important, like rather than everybody having their own car, why not we share the resources, right?
Yeah, correct.
Correct. So sharing the resources is a primary important function that happens in virtualization and cloud computing that will help us achieve extreme level of efficiency in IT infrastructure provision. Okay. So what does virtualization do? The first and foremost thing that it does is sharing. Let's do a carpool. Let's share a car. Isn't it?
Yes.
Okay. Now, what does virtualization do? It allows you to do maximum resource utilization. Isn't it?
Yes.
Something similar to what you see in this picture.
Yes, yeah.
not exactly. It's not about filling up resources. It's more about doing more with the same. Correct. So we are just giving traffic examples. Can you see the screen now?
Yes.
Have you played this game before?
Maybe long time back. Don't
yeah, you, you know what this game is about, right?
Yeah.
Okay, Prasad.
Yes, yes, definitely.
Okay. So the point I was trying to mention is that if you look at this game, it depicts a very serious situation similar to what our data centers look like. To start with, our data centers are literally empty. And then we start putting down machines and different servers and IT resources and stuff like that, which are all of different shapes. Okay. What happens is like different blocks coming out in this game, we have different blocks of infrastructure sitting in the data center. Now what's run you through just the virtualization stack as such, because we'll have to use KVM now, okay, while installing. So
tomorrow,
come again?
So tomorrow also schedule for the same time, right?
I wanted to...
Oh, no problem. Let's carry on. Yeah.
Okay. So, you know, what primarily we do is that we have different components here. Okay. So, with different components in the sense, different machines, individual machines. Now, we are able to put it in a single stack, post-virtualization. That means, one machine can handle multiple machines within itself.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, that's what virtualization do. Now, we have different virtual, I mean, individual physical machines. Now we introduce something called the hypervisor layer here, and that allows multiple machines to run on top of an existing layer. Okay, that's the simplest definition of virtualization, is that ability to run multiple operating systems concurrently on a single shared hardware. Okay?
Okay. Yeah.
So there are primarily two major types of virtualization. So the type one is where the hypervisor sits on top of the hardware directly, where the hypervisor acts as if it is an operating system. And this one is called type one virtualization or a bare metal virtualization. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a second type called type two virtualization or a host OS based virtualization, where the hypervisor is installed on top of an existing OS, where it is mostly an application that runs on top of a existing OS, may it be Linux or a Windows machine or a Solaris or Linux, anything, any of the sort. And there are different kinds of them. And generally, type 2 is not a production worthy thing because you have multiple layers before it actually reaches the hardware. Okay. So in type 1, you have only one layer extra added, which is the hypervisor layer. So type 1 is the one that is mostly used for full operating system virtualization in enterprises. So mm-hmm. there is a variation which is not actually called as type 3, but it is called as para virtualization, where it looks like type 2, where the hypervisor sits on top of an existing host OS. Okay, and the hypervisor can bypass the underlying OS and talk to the hardware directly, which gives us a performance like type 2. It looks like type 2 and behaves like type 1. Thing is that it has the flexibility of what type 2 hypervisors will provide, but it can perform as good as type 1 hypervisors. And this is the simplest definition for para-virtualization. Primarily, para-virtualized hypervisors have specialized drivers which will allow it to talk to the hardware directly, bypassing the host OS. So host OS and para-virtualized hypervisors work together at the same level. Examples of which are OpenZen and KVMs. Okay. Hello.
Right.
Okay, so
even Citrix, right?
Come again? Yes, Citrix doesn't really para-virtualize. Citrix Zen server as it is a type 1. Citrix Zen server is type 1. Citrix's Zen is taken from OpenZen server. Citrix customizes it and has its own hypervisor. Zen server is pure type 1, which is bare metal. Okay. There is something
so in type 2, right? In type 2, then what value is the host OS actually providing?
Host OS, see, in type 1, I told you the hypervisor acts as if it's an operating system, right?
Correct.
Okay, so what happens is it's not a full-fledged operating system.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very thin OS.
Mm-hmm.
say for example, ESX has around a footprint of 35 MB or something. Okay.
Right.
It's very simple. It's a very thin one. And most of the times, you will need an external management server or a management application to handle the hypervisor.
Correct.
Whereas, in typical type 2, you can utilize an existing host OS. Say for an example, you can even run your own native application from the host OS.
Right.
Alongside other VMs.
Right.
Say for an example, you can have a Windows operating system in your laptop. Anyways, right. We'll be using type 2 here, in our lab. Okay.
Right.
So you can use a Windows OS on the host operating system. And you can run a Linux and a Mac OS on VMs.
Right.
In the Windows.
Carry on.
No. What I was saying is that in the Windows machine, through this Windows machine, you are able to manage the hypervisor. So you don't need a separate management layer or anything like that. It makes the, it gives you a lot more flexibility of managing the hypervisors and everything.
Type 3, right? I actually misstated the question. Type 3 basically, what value the host OS provides. So you're telling type 3 is like hypervisor directly accessing the hardware, bypassing the host OS. So what is the value add for type 3?
The primary thing is that it can work along with the existing operating system to do system calls. One, paravirtualized hypervisors, which is not type 3 as such, it's generally called paravirtualization, is a variant of type 2. Okay. The hypervisors are again very thin. And they are built with specialized drivers that can help with hardware access. At the same time, where they don't have to be operating systems.
Right.
So there is no special management layer that is needed. You can manage, say, for example, a KVM with the base Red Hat or base Ubuntu or anything. You don't need a separate management layer, that is as it is in hypervisor. So the number of components in a typical type 1 goes larger. Okay. The type 3, as you call it, paravirtualized hypervisors are built to be more efficient. They are very thin applications. It resides along with the kernel of the host OS. So communication to the hardware is better because it can reside along with the existing OS. It need not have a kernel on its own. Okay. It can work along with the kernel of the host OS. So there is an interoperability between the host OS and the hypervisor. So manageability and flexibility are easier. You can install the hypervisor as if you are installing an application. Easily.
Okay.
You understand?
Yeah.
Okay. So that is the reason why paravirtualization nowadays are more preferred. You can bundle it with your existing enterprise operating system and put it across. Say for example, Ubuntu or a Red Hat or a CentOS. Okay. Can we bundle with KVMs and Zens and you can deploy it. Rather, if you want to put up a full-fledged Zen server or something, there are multiple components needed. You need a Zen server, then you need a management server, then you need another application and stuff like that. Okay, where all of these can be bundled into the host OS itself here. That's a major advantage.
But in Zen server, you don't need a management host, right? You can have Zen Center called to the pool master basically.
No, Zen Center is what then?
Zen Center is basically on your laptop, right?
No, see, on your laptop or it could be anything, right? End of the day, you need a separate client.
You need a client, yes.
You need a client, right? So here, the host OS itself can be a machine. That itself can be the client.
Yeah, then okay.
You don't really do everything on the Zen server, unless otherwise you are doing a command line operation, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so apart from it, the hypervisors are built to be very thin and extremely efficient. That's also one of the primary reasons.
Yeah.
Okay, does it answer your question?
Yeah. Yep.
Okay. Prasad, is it clear to you? Shall we move?
Yes, you can.
No, Prasad, if it's not clear, feel free to ask.
No, are you able to hear me?
Yeah, I am able to hear you.
Okay. It's clear, we can move on.
Okay, so looking at different things on virtualization in general, the major attributes are these. Okay. One, these are the major attributes of cloud computing in general as per NIST definition. And the major attributes are One, you need to have an on-demand self-service or a self-service portal through which you can ask for a particular resource and the resources are provided on demand. Okay. The second thing is you have a broad network access through which you will be able to access the cloud resources from anywhere, literally across the network. The third thing is resource pooling. Resource pooling is where you will be able to share resources, like we saw this car pooling thing. We'll be able to share the resources and provision it through network. Fourth one is the measured service in terms of what are all the resources that we use. You are able to break it into pieces and measure and meter them individually. The fourth one or the fifth one or the most important one is the ability not just to increase the resources or the way we call it as scalability, or we should be able to increase as well as decrease the resources on demand. That is what is called elasticity. Okay. So these attributes will be able to set up in a cloud, that is residing inside one our premises, is what we call as a private cloud. Okay. So the major differences are commonalities between virtualization and cloud are all these do abstraction. They have sharing in between, flexibility and containers. Cloud is more a concept where virtualization is a technology. Okay. So we know infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and software as a service, right? Now, as we were discussing, OpenStack is an implementation of infrastructure as a service, where storage as well as virtual machines, their processing, memory capacity, network, and other related things can be supplied as service, that you can access or request for a particular virtualized infrastructure, and that infrastructure can be provisioned to a self-service portal, is what infrastructure as a service can do. OpenStack, Eucalyptus, there are quite a few, like Windows Azure, all these things are classical examples of cloud engines that can create infrastructure as a service models, on top of which you can create PaaS and SaaS as well. Okay. So these are the major components here, and so you know that private cloud, public cloud difference, right? So private cloud is nothing but it is completely on-premise or specific to a particular customer, where a public cloud is anybody can go in and access and use things on their own. And OpenStack is mostly used in private cloud implementations. Rackspace, right?
Yes.
Okay. So Rackspace is one of the major public cloud service providers which uses OpenStack. Even today, Rackspace is one of the major contributors to OpenStack code. Okay.
There is something called CloudStack also, right? So is it similar to OpenStack or something?
Actually speaking, I'll give you one. I've just passed my screen. Okay, so just to get back to it. Actually, CloudStack, all these cloud computing stacks started from something called the Nebula project. Okay. NASA by principle open sources all its IT innovations. Similarly, for NASA, huge amount of high performance computing machines were needed, right? So internally for their services, they created a project which will provision on-demand machines for their high performance computing setup, and that project they named it as Nebula project. Okay, so the Nebula project was open source, and that is the source for OpenStack and other people also. There is, you might have heard of something called Open Nebula also. Okay, so it all started with Nebula code. Okay, all these people have Nebula code as their base. That is the reason even OpenStack's components names like Nova, Swift, Cinder, Glance, all these things are nothing but the names of galaxies and stars and other things. Okay, so it all starts from Nebula project. Once OpenStack Foundation was created and it was started running, a new company named cloud.com came into picture. These people customized the OpenStack code and created a new stack called CloudStack. So CloudStack's founding code is obviously OpenStack. Over a period of time, like 2 years back or 2.5 years back, Citrix bought out CloudStack. Okay, so CloudStack as a premium version through Citrix, as well as it is completely open sourced with Apache license as Apache CloudStack also. CloudStack is a variant of OpenStack, but it is maintained as a separate project. It is, I guess, it's separate releases. It has its own modified code, everything. But the base is OpenStack for these people. The original base is Nebula project.
Okay, thanks.
Does it answer your question?
Yeah, yeah. Okay. I swear it somewhere and read something about it, so I just thought of checking with you.
Yeah, the way CloudStack will work at all, see, if you look at it, any cloud engine only has only a set of components. Set of components that do a, you know, set of standard services. For that matter, only OpenStack has a very, you know, variation. Other than that, Eucalyptus and Amazon Web Services and stuff like that have very, very similar architecture. I mean, Eucalyptus literally mimics Amazon Web Services architecture. Okay. So, OpenStack and CloudStack have very similar architecture where each component is a separate service or vice versa. Each service is a separate component which talks through a, one second, which talks through a, which talks through a messaging server and talks to each other. We will be implementing every one of them and we will be understanding each of them. The primary idea is having each service as a separate component and provisioning around it, and you can decide which service you want to provision or not provision. CloudStack has very, very similar structure, but on the code level and similar stuff, it kind of deviates. Okay? Is it clear?
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Any questions, Anik, now?
No, I'm fine.
Yeah, okay. So, as I told you, I mean, OpenStack now is nothing but a system that can handle, you know, your IT infrastructure with these set of principles. Remember, any cloud engine has two primary functions if it is at the infrastructure as a service layer. Mm-hmm. Okay. Can you tell me what those two services can be?
Can you repeat the question once again? Sorry.
I'm saying any cloud servers can be divided into two different categories if it is working on the infrastructure as a service level. What can they be?
Don't know. Sorry.
Any idea?
Me too. I don't know.
You can just, you know, maybe try a little think of it. See. Hold on. Now, if you look at infrastructure service, what are all the different infrastructure components you will get normally?
You have the compute, storage.
Yeah, you said that, right? It has to be compute and storage. So similar, I mean, you might have used in Amazon Web Services or something, right?
Yeah.
What do you call compute in Amazon?
EC2.
EC2, right?
Yep.
Okay. Storage?
S3.
Yes. EBS or
S3. Yeah.
S3, right?
Or EBS.
Now, EBS still comes under EC2. If you look at the top layer, I'll tell you why. I'll tell you how. Okay. So, can you use EBS without EC2?
No.
That directly answers the question, right?
Yeah, you're correct.
So the major on top, the major layers are two layers. One is a computing layer, another one is a storage layer. So that is the one that I was asking you, where if you have to divide the whole infrastructure as a service thing, it comes into two things. One is computing as a service, and another one is storage as a service. are storage alone as a service, correct? So that is what we have in Amazon as web services, and EC2, which is nothing but Elastic Compute Cloud, and S3, which is nothing but Simple Storage Service. Simple Storage Service is a object-based storage, as we call it. All it has is complete storage alone setup. Whereas when we say computing, it means processor, memory, disk, network, correct, in which disk is taken through EBS. Isn't
yeah,
it?
That's a good logic, yeah.
Come again?
That's a good logic.
Yeah, so that is how it happened, because there are two kinds of people. Right? Say for an example, I don't want a machine to store something. I want to just store objects. I just want to use storage. In that case, I don't have to build a machine, add storage to it, maintain a file system, create a folder, do stuff, and keep storage and access it, which becomes too difficult or unnecessarily complicated for a usage, where all that I want to do is just storage.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas any other component other than storage cannot be used standalone. It has to come inclusive of a machine.
Mm-hmm.
Correct. That is why the overall layer is bifurcated into two major areas as computing and storage. So similar to Amazon Web Services, OpenStack also primarily has two different layers. So OpenStack internally uses every single component as a separate service. I'll explain about it more when we come to that. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But primary, you guys are able to look at the screen, right?
Yes.
Okay. So when you look at the whole stack for any cloud computing engine, as I said, some components of the architecture are very, very similar. Similarly, Eucalyptus also has something called a cloud controller and Walrus, which is nothing but your equivalent to EC2 and S3. Right? How does it work on OpenStack? We'll look at the components later. So if you think of infrastructure as a service, it's nothing but there is an engine. Now if you have to provision, that's the reason why I was getting a little deep into the ideas of virtualization and everything, like the reasons for virtualization and how virtualization works and how does it do sharing, is because this, the whole idea of virtualization has given us a capability to consider machines as software resources, correct?
Correct.
Correct. We can create machines through configuration files now.
Correct.
So, what is a virtual machine?
It's a file basically.
It's a
file basically, right?
Very good. So that's the right word. So it is not just a file, it's a set of files. From a hypervisor's point of view,
yeah.
It's a set of files. I mean, your answer is pretty much right. Okay, so it's a set of files where there are two components, right? Storage and this. So any this component will have only this. I was telling that why virtualization becomes important is virtualized machines are nothing but set of files. Correct?
Right.
Okay. So when you say set of files, what are the set of files we have? And it said we have a config file and we have a disk file. So this file is nothing but your virtual disk file, which contains the data of a virtual machine, where the configuration file is nothing but a text file, correct?
Yes.
It only tells the hypervisor what amount of resources I want from where. That's all it is. So that configuration file is all that computing can be. So when you have to create a new computing resource, all you have to do is to create a configuration file or create or modify an existing file, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Isn't it?
That is correct.
Say for an example, I edit the configuration file, I change the 2 GB to 4 GB, then my virtual machine gets 4 GB of RAM.
Yep.
Yes.
So it is just like changing a number.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you look at cloud computing, where we will have to provision huge amount of resources in a minute, or we might have different size clusters and different size machines, etc., etc. In that case, what exactly happens? We should be able to provision machines on the fly, correct?
Yes.
So provisioning machines on the fly happens because we are able to treat infrastructure a set of files. We create new sets of files, or we modify existing sets of files, or we create new configurations of the file, isn't it?
Yes.
That is why cloud computing, for that matter, now hypervisors have already existed. We have had virtualization set up like, you know, VMware and Zen and stuff like that, which will create virtual machines for you, isn't it?
Yes.
Is it right? Now, what is the difference then between a cloud and a virtualization?
Yes, that's a good question, right? So.
Now, even in EC2, you get virtual machines. Even in Eucalyptus, you get virtual machines and everything. Now, what can be the difference between a Zen server and a AWS?
Zen server and AWS?
No, I'm saying like a virtualized system and this one.
I think self-service.
Very good. Self-service is a very, very critical component, right? Okay, good. Uh-huh. Self-service. Yeah. What else can you think of?
Certainly from the user, so there is perspective of who are you asking, right? Mm. If I am the user, I have self-service.
Mm-hmm.
I have elasticity,
right? Very good. Elasticity,
I can ask for 10 machines and get 10 machines,
mm-hmm.
right? Whereas if I am using something like vCenter,
mm.
User has no access, first of all, so user cannot do it.
Uh-huh.
So user uses what is given, whereas in self-service, user dictates what needs to be done.
The user can request for resource.
Right. User can request for resource without intervention from a sysadmin.
Absolutely. That's the most important point. Without intervention, what can you call it?
Self-service, yeah?
Yeah, self-service is a very good word. It is more, the request response cycle is automated.
Yes, okay.
Would you call it more automated? Self-service is where the user can go and ask for something, but the provisioning is automatic. Nobody sits on the other side of your table and does something, correct?
Yeah.
So self-service is not equivalent to automatic. So self-service is important. Automation is important. Very good. Automation and self-service leads to elasticity.
That is a good point.
Isn't it?
Yep.
Prasad, do you agree?
Yes.
Okay. I mean, the reason why I asked is to make sure that you are there.
Yeah, no, I'm here.
Hey, I was just kidding. Okay. Now, that is where a very, very crucial component comes. Can we call cloud as a hypervisor management layer?
That's one of the things it does, but that's not all, right?
That's not all, but can we? Isn't that a very important thing that a cloud generally can do?
Yes.
Because the reason is that we talk about self-service, we talk about automation, but end of the day, machines are created and given. Storage is created and given, correct?
Yes.
That machine creation is something the hypervisors have been doing anyways. Isn't it?
Yes.
If I can talk to Zen server, if I can tell Zen server in an automated way, if the user asks for a thing, and if it can provision virtual machines and give the access to me, then what I have is a layer on top of Zen servers, correct?
Mm-hmm.
It can be a Zen server, it can be vCenter, it can be a KVM, it can be Hyper-V. It can be a combination of all or all of them. I have a way of talking to them and getting the resources where I want, where I have a self-service and an automated way of doing this where there is little or no manual intervention, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is correct.
So, I don't have to create another hypervisor which will give me storage, network, disk, this and that, but I have a comprehensive layer on top which can talk to hypervisors and ask them to do this work, isn't it?
That is correct, yeah.
That is what? Come again?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, sorry, carry on.
No, you said something.
I'm thinking like it's something analogous to sort of a script, right? I mean, you can tell it that way.
It's something analogous to?
A script, right?
In a way, a script. It is, yeah. See, the automation and the self-service portal are nothing but scripts. It is not just a script, it is a little beyond that. Okay.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. So script helps you to do some programming. Script is like asking you a set of instructions primarily. Scripting you use to automate. I mean, I understand that you say that there is no manual intervention, so it's all scripted.
Yeah,
it is correct. But so
there's a workflow idea. There's
correct,
an idea of workflow.
Correct.
That is the important part.
Exactly. The workflow is a more appropriate and a generic word. Okay.
Yeah.
So workflow internally might employ scripts to do it. Where here it is not a script, it's more a web service.
Yeah.
Internally, each component has to talk to each other in a way where they can interoperate and create a single instance of a machine.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't it?
Yes.
You understand that, right? So this is where a huge difference comes in, where if you look at a Zen server, if you look at a VMware vCenter or even a VirtualBox or a VMware workstation for that matter, any machine whatsoever, all that does is it creates a machine that is very similar to a virtual machine, I mean physical machine, correct? We created a standard machine.
Yep.
Where we again put a CD or point an ISO, we build the machine, then we give network access, this, we do all sorts of configurations. It's as good as creating a physical machine. Only thing is that you have a portal to do or an interface to do or a client to do all these things rather than building a physical machine assets, isn't it?
Yes.
Do you agree?
Yes.
If you have a contradicting point, you can say so. Creating a virtual machine is as bad as creating a physical machine, isn't it?
In a way, yeah.
I agree. Not the same. But what I'm saying is that you have to build configuration. Say, for example, I want to create a Windows 2008 with Active Directory. Okay. Now, what I have to do, I'll have to point a Windows 2008. I'll have to specify how much of disk I'll have to give, what kind of, how much RAM I need, what number of processors do I need. I'll have to install the complete operating system, install whatever patches I need, etc., etc. Then, set up Active Directory, make it available. By the time I get the machine, whatever I will do in a physical machine, apart from touching the physical server, I'll have to do everything in a virtual machine also, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Is it right or not?
Yes. That's correct.
Okay. Now, what if I need so many number of machines right now? Can I go on giving all these credentials, maintaining things, building the machine, everything, when I need it so quick? An average time to set up a server like this will take an hour or an hour or two, isn't it?
Yeah, and unless you are scripting it, yeah.
Unless you are, I mean, even when you do a script, you know, where do you do scripting? Installing the machine itself, isn't it? You'll have to script the installation itself. You said you do a lot of CentOS and other stuff, right? CentOS and Red Hat and stuff. You might have heard of Kickstart installers and stuff.
Yes.
Which is nothing but every part
you have to script.
Every part you will have to, I mean, every step you can automate and stuff. What you are doing is that you are reducing manual intervention, but it still takes its own sweet time to get installed and get it ready, isn't it?
Yes.
You might have used Amazon Web Services or any cloud service for that matter. You click, in a couple of minutes, it is available to you, isn't it?
Yes.
There is a huge difference, isn't it?
There is.
Do you see it, Prasad?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, don't you see there is something more to it than creating a virtual machine? We are not just creating a virtual machine. We call it here as an instance.
Uh-huh.
In cloud terminologies, we don't create machines. Rather, we create instances of machine.
Mm-hmm.
Which is used in virtualization terminology also to some extent. I don't know if you guys have used desktop virtualization much, something called as VDI.
No, I have not used.
Have you done any?
Zen desktop.
So. Zen desktop you would have used, right? Zen desktop has a little bit of this.
Yeah.
But anyways, coming back to this, when we create, say for example, I'm deploying a virtualized infrastructure for a college. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you can treat desktops in the same way you treat servers, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So, in that case, now 500 students from computer sciences department will need a machine with 1 GB RAM, a 20 GB hard disk, Windows XP with Java install. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I need 500 machines. Now what, how will I do it in a vCenter or Zen server? You create one machine, maybe you clone it, or through command line you can do multiple clones, etc. Isn't it?
Yes.
What you do is you create 500 standalone machines of this.
Mm-hmm.
The first machine is where you will do all the your own seed time installations and everything. Then you put the application, you set it up and everything. Correct? Yeah. Now, can we have something where we just go templates and appliances?
That appliance I have not used it actually.
Like you have used it?
No, I have not used it. That
be, but you have heard of it, right?
Yeah, I just heard of it. That's it.
Yeah, that's fine. That's good enough. See, appliances are very simple. Have you heard of physical appliances? Physical IT appliances, I mean. I'm not talking about home appliances. Have you heard of physical appliances as such?
No.
Okay. Have you seen your firewall? Firewall of your, not the firewall of your desktop or laptop. Have you seen the enterprise firewall?
The network thing?
Yes.
Yes, I've seen it.
You would have seen somewhere, right? Anik, you would have seen as well, right?
Yeah, I've seen.
The easiest one is your router or switch.
Yeah.
The routers and switches are nothing but physical appliances. You buy a router, okay? You buy a router and connect it to your telephone line, and you connect a LAN cable to it or switch it on. You can go to 192.168.1.1 or whatever equivalent of it, and you see a web interface, right?
Yep.
That web interface is what? Is an application that is running inside the router, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
If an application has to run, that router has to have some sort of an operating system, correct?
Mm-hmm.
But who installed it?
Manufacturer.
Correct. So the router came inbuilt. It's a router appliance. You don't have to buy a router, install it, maintain it, do anything. But all you have to do is to buy a router, switch it on, plug a cable, it starts working. Similarly, can we have virtual appliances? We can, isn't it?
Yeah.
Now, virtual appliances are nothing but combination of operating system plus application.
Mm-hmm.
They are nothing but pre-built VMs.
Mm-hmm.
Because somebody, see, now Windows 2008 with Active Directory is such a common requirement for n number of organizations, isn't it?
Sorry, say the last one.
Windows 2008 with Active Directory, yeah, will be a very, very common, you know, requirement for so many organizations, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay. Similarly, Red Hat with a particular application, Red Hat with Oracle, or SAP installed in a Linux machine, or a particular ERP in some machine, whatever application and whatever machine, a LAMP stack with Ubuntu. These are all common examples, right? These are all the things which somebody doesn't have. And Prasad has also dropped out of the thing.
So tomorrow is fine with me. I mean,
okay. So, I mean, whatever we have tomorrow discussed now, do you find it useful?
Yeah, very useful. You're doing the right thing. No problem at all.
Okay. So, I mean, yeah. I didn't have a background of you guys, so I thought I will go through.
No, that is fine. Obviously, how will you know, right? So that's
yeah, obviously. I mean, I didn't even know how many people are going to come. I reached back.
So this is very useful. No problem at all.
Okay, so we'll understand it. I mean, if we understand these things, see, it's not just about installation, right? In other way, we need to understand how things work and we should be able
I mean, you have to understand concepts only, right? So that's fine.
So that will help, I guess. We will, you know, touch base again at 8 o'clock sharp tomorrow morning. Okay.
Okay.
And 8 o'clock, right? I hope 8 o'clock IST. Okay. So I'll assume Prasad will be available as well. Okay.
Okay. Yeah.
Fine.
Sure.
Nice talking to you, Anik. Have a good day ahead. Yeah. I'll touch base with you again tomorrow morning.
Yeah. Tomorrow. Bye.
Bye, Prasad. If you are there. Bye.